And before we get started, I want to remind our audience that WNYC's talk box is waiting for you out in the lobby. I don't know if you saw it. It looks like an old telephone booth. You can pick it up. You pick up the handset, and there will be a recording there asking you to answer a question about social justice. The question is about the most important social justice issue for you at this time. And you record your answer, and you may hear it played tomorrow on our air on WNYC. And we did this last year, and it was hugely successful. So we hope you'll participate. It's right out there in the Apollo lobby, so please stop by the talk box on your way out this afternoon. So let's begin our final panel. Where do we go from here? No pressure.
Hide.
All right, Joshua, I'm starting with you, my man. We've been spending a lot of time talking about where we go from here as we listen to all of the poetry, beautiful music, the other panels. And Joshua, you've expressed a pretty sobering sense of where we go from here in the black community and as a country. So what is the remedy? Where do we go from here, in your view, from where you sit, from your vantage point?
From where I sit, I think one of the things we need to recognize, one of the conversations I was having, with my friends over the break at our Kwanzaa party, was just how much we need to recognize how hopeless some of these situations are that we really are in. And that's, I understand this is an MLK, day in which we want to talk about the hope, but I think we also need to recognize it's pretty hopeless for a lot of people. We talk about the ways in which the potential for these Trump policies to actually have an effect on real lives, that people might literally lose their life as a result of these policies that are about to be in place from the repeal of the ACA all the way to immigration policies and stuff like that. We're talking about actual, literal, this is not hyperbole.
So when you say hopeless,
I'm talking about actual hopeless situations where people actually don't have agency in their own lives to remedy the change that they need to see in their own lives. And I want to recognize that, so it's kind of hard for me at this exact moment to actually talk about hope. Right. The best I can say in the midst of that is for people to stay vigilant.
Right.
To stay vigilant. I'm not sure what that necessarily needs to look like for each individual person, but for individual groups and communities, to stay vigilant. If that looks like going to vote, that's what you need to do. If that means protest, that's what you need to do.
Right, because in order to be active and to be vigilant, you first have to recognize the problem.
You have to recognize the problem. And the problem is pretty effing bad. I'm trying not to cuss right now. But
well, we've had some cussing.
We did. We did earlier. But I think we need to recognize just how, I speak in from a position of power. I have a modicum of privilege given the place that I work and the opportunities that I have. But I want to recognize some people don't have those privileges. Some people don't have those opportunities. And I would say even in the midst of all of that, part of my call is to middle class people who have the privilege, use the privilege for the people that don't have those opportunities.
Okay, so first we have to call it out.
I think we need to call it out.
All right. So then, Elie, let me come to you and let's talk very specifically about a couple of things. First, where do we go from here on the Supreme Court? Where do we go from here on the Department of Justice? Right. Are we optimistic? Are we pessimistic?
Part of doing what Joshua talks about doing, I think, for people with privilege, for people with a little bit of power, it might literally involve going to jail. Because we cannot expect the law to be on the side of right going forward. Specifically with the Supreme Court, I don't know if all of you have heard, but today it came out that Ted Cruz rejected Trump's nomination for the Supreme Court. It always helps when your enemies are stupid, so that's good. But we're gonna get, my pick, I think we're gonna get a guy named William Pryor, who is white and hates women, so it kind of works right in with Trump's thing. He's come out strong against Roe. He's come out strong against Miranda. I think he's most likely to be our fifth Supreme Court justice. I would say to people who are particularly worried about the Supreme Court, now is not yet
the
time.
You mean our fifth conservative Supreme Court justice.
Bill Pryor, I think, is probably a bad guy, but he's not going to be more conservative than Antonin Scalia. So it's not like the court is going to lurch significantly further to the right than it already has been. Now, personally, I'm sending Ruth Bader Ginsburg vitamin supplements. I encourage all of you to do the same thing. Like, it's... If Trump gets two, we're going to be in some trouble. But if he only has one, it's going to be how it is. The thing we should freak out about is Jeff Sessions, right? That's real. That's a real problem.
To head the Justice Department.
To head the Department of Justice. That's a real problem coming down the pipe at us. And the thing that I want to... Because we all need to, the thing that we all need to be aware of, the thing that we all need to recognize when it's happening, is that it doesn't take, Sessions doesn't have to overturn laws. He can simply choose not to enforce the ones we already have. And he's going to have that power. It's going to be open. If you are a boss who wants to hit on your female colleague, open season. If you are an employer who wants to deny basic rights to your employees, open season. Because Sessions controls the Civil Rights Division of the Department of Justice, the EEOC, which is who you go to when your boss mistreats you. All of these things are kind of up for...
Equal Employment Opportunity Commission.
All of these things are things that Sessions can do and might do, and certainly will have the power to do once he's installed there. And so I think that's going to be... There's going to be a lot of pain as we figure out how to resist him. And, you know, like we were talking about backstage, I think for every person who would resist, I think we all have to ask ourselves the question, at what point is it time to go to jail? Just at what point is resisting this law, is it going to require, you know, a couple of days in the paddy wagon?
Okay. I'm going to bring it around to some optimism. I am, before we end the last and final panel. Rabbi, Dr. King asked this question. Why does white America delude itself, and how does it rationalize the evil it retains? So I'm gonna paraphrase a little bit. I'm gonna paraphrase for the 21st century and ask, why does white, male, heterosexual, and I could fill in a few more, America delude itself, and how does it rationalize the supremacy it retains?
Well, we're talking about insecurity. I mean, that's the bottom line. I mean, these people are insecure. The only way these many white men who did vote that way, and I've heard them. I've heard them in the taxi cabs and in my own congregation that I serve and seminars that I attend. The only way that some white folks can feel good about themselves is to feel large is to make other folks feel small. And we're going to fight against that. We're going to move from Trump's gossip culture, Dr. King's gospel culture. We're going to go back to faith. We're going to change how religion itself operates, because religion too often is about I. I can be saved. I can do this. I can do that. It's about we. We can be saved. We got to move it from Trump's I to Dr. King's we. And I want to say, this day is not about Trump. This is about Dr. King's sweet legacy. This nation does not belong to Trump. It belongs to Dr. King's legacy. So we can be saved. We can be saved. That's the answer we got to give.
Only I can fix it. Eljoy, Sally Maria has a question. She writes, as a Latina student in the 80s whose parents were late 60s activists, what is the role, if any, of coalition politics and attempts to get equality for marginalized groups? Is there a united front now? She finishes.
Well, I think back to how I began the conversation on our last panel in discussing how Dr. King, in his later commentary, his later speeches, talked about how we had won the fight for the Voting Rights Act, we had won the fight on the Civil Rights Act, and that these major pieces were major, certainly, milestones in the movement, but yet still there was work yet to be done, which was the theme of the text. And the work that he was talking about was one of the building the coalition and for working class whites and for other people of color to see themselves in the movement and to see yourself being beneficial into, if I join in this movement to help empower and ensure that African Americans have their full citizenship in this democracy. At the same time, I am lifting up a working class or poor white person who is experiencing economic issues that they're facing, and at the same time focusing on the issues of immigration, the issues, sort of all of that diaspora of issues that people who are not white males in this country are experiencing. So I lead back to that. And so to Joshua's point of people feeling hopeless, I'm reminded in talking about checking our privilege that that hopelessness existed before Trump and existed for a lot of people and still exists, whether the president was Barack Obama, whether it's George Bush, whether it's Clinton, whether it's now Trump, there are still people experiencing that hopelessness. And so how we move forward is not just creating these full inclusive organizations and collectives as to make sure that we have physical representation that you can see that, oh, I have a white person, oh, I have, you know, a Latina, oh, I have a black woman. And so I've created this full example of collaborative work, mm-hmm. but doing some real equity work and making sure that we are bringing people to a level of equity in this country. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to be represented just by face. Right. I want a clear voice. I want a clear and equal voice at the table, and that may require, in order to create that equity, that special that privileges, that more work, more money, more things need to go into immigrant communities mm-hmm. because they have a language barrier that I don't have, or more resources and things need to go in the LGBT community that our young people who fit in that enclave in New York City are on the streets, right? More resources may need to go there in order to bring them to parity, in order to bring them to equity, so that we can fight equally. So don't ask me to fight when I am in this hopeless situation, this economic, you can't ask someone who is really thinking about how I'm gonna eat tomorrow to fight. But we have to advance as a middle class, as whoever, in making sure that we have equity and parity. So we may have to fight for you until we can get you to the level of equity and parity.
I want to ask each of you this last question that came in from Dylan Groves. I'm pretty much out of time, but I want to hear from each of you on this. And Dylan, I want to thank all of you who wrote in. We got so many fantastic questions. I wish I could ask them all. And I know Brian feels the same way. Which of the many emotions that animated the work of Dr. Martin Luther King, anger, compassion, empathy, hopefulness, joy, despair, should be the animating force of activists in the contemporary political moment? I guess I'll start with you, Joshua.
I think anger should be one. The reason I say anger is because I think anger is, when people get angry as hell, I think they can become motivated to actually get up off of their butts and actually do something, say something, write something, be something that they would not have been before.
I probably would, if I'm forced to choose between those, I'll probably choose anger as well. But I mean,
what
I say, resistance, refusal to go along with what they're telling us is acceptable. I say it's not acceptable, and I'll, you know, you have to be willing to fight that. You know, I've said to my family, I will fight this man every second of every day for every year until they lose.
repeat the
Yes, I saw you.
Because I want to string them all together.
Well, Dylan gave us anger, compassion, empathy, hopefulness, joy, Eljoy, and despair. But you can certainly choose another.
Yeah, I would have to agree that the hand in hand of anger yet resistance is what you know what we need. I think certainly, you know, you can make the argument for empathy. Certainly the press is making that for us and why we should be empathetic to the white man, that he felt that he was losing his American dream and that's the reason why he vote. You know, so they're doing that for us. Right? They're doing that for us, so we don't have to do that one. We'll put that over there. But I think the the anger into the resistance is certainly useful, and particularly in going to text, being a church girl, that is the sin isn't in the anger, right? Am I right?
Sure.
but is in your actions, right? And so that it is okay that your feeling of anger is valid, and it is okay. Now it's the action, and I would say that you know where they talk about the sin is in the action, it's also in the inaction. So at the end of this, can you look and see that everyone else has done something except for you, right? So that so the sin is also in the inaction, in addition to the action.
Thank you, Rabbi.
You have to pick anger now.
You know, we're here to remember Martin Luther King. He would have been 88 years old today. And I believe that he would have preferred to have been a grandfather rather than a legend.
Yes.
And I don't know about all these words, but I look at him, his persona, his mood swings, his loneliness in jail, his remarkable ability to mimic other preachers, sometimes not to their great joy. And I think the word is passion. And in fact, if I may, I'd like to quote Dr. King. Somebody sent me this brief quote from the man who brought us here together in inclusiveness. Martin King said, "Human progress is neither automatic nor inevitable. Every step toward the goal of justice requires sacrifice, suffering, and struggle. The tireless exertion and the passionate concern of dedicated individuals." And we need to be passionate and dedicated individuals in one big nation of we.
Thank you, Rabbi, for that. And I can't think of a better way to end this panel. Joshua Lazard, Elie Mystal, Eljoy Williams, and Rabbi Benjamin Kamin. Thank you.